We'll perhaps start by presenting a couple of personal perspectives, so especially on the origins of this crisis, from two very special OSCE-related angles. The first is the fact that Ukraine had the chairmanship of the OSCE last year. So I was regularly in Kiev. I met a number of times with the president. I went to Crimea a number of times. And I saw very closely the process leading up to Vilnius and the crisis, of course, and we had a ministerial in December in Kiev, where a number of ministers were there, but where the attention was almost more on what was going outside the conference room than to the discussions inside. The second angle, also related to the OSCE, is the debate we have on the organization looking, and this is something that Serbia will inherit as the chairmanship next year, the debate on what we call Helsinki plus 40, where there is the idea and the strategy is to try to move towards a common security space, as we call it, from Vancouver to Vladivostok, something that was designed in Astana, but something that ended up clashing against the notion of different, spheres within the organization possibly colliding with each other. So on the first point, what I saw last year was a genuine determination of Ukrainian leadership to engage more deeply with the European Union. I met with Commissioner Füle a number of times. I was always encouraged by the Ukrainian leadership to look and also to present, in a way, the work that Ukraine was doing within the OSCE as a sign of the genuine will of Ukraine to move towards the European Union. I never detected one of the things we are seeing now, which is the difference of opinions or different attitudes within Ukraine vis-a-vis the European perspective. That we see now as one of the divisive elements in the Ukrainian society. Something I remember to at least to a certain extent from 2004, when I was also in Ukraine in a different context, but during the Orange Revolution, because I was at the time head of the Conflict Prevention Center of the OSCE. And I saw the demonstrations. I remember demonstrations from the people from Donetsk coming up, led by Yanukovych, flying, however, Ukrainian flags, not Russian flags at the time, which is an interesting difference with some of the things we see in the streets today. Yanukovych seems to me was, in respect of the European perspective, a kind of a reassurance or unifying element in a way. But of course, the way he was presenting the steps in deepening cooperation of Ukraine with the European Union was always presented in a very careful and balanced manner, saying this will go ahead with a continuation of a strong cooperation with Russia. I heard a number of times statements on the compatibility and full compatibility of the deep comprehensive trade area with the customs union, which often were denied by people in Brussels and perhaps even by people in Moscow. So Ukraine ended up at some point, and Yanukovych personally ended up in a situation when he realized that these assumptions working on both elements and proceeding on the two tracks in parallel, in fact, didn't have enough buy-in by the actors concerned. And then when this was coupled with the problems that he had on the economy, the energy, and he needed the support that had become very clearly something extremely urgent and dramatic, then at that point he became vulnerable and then he had to obviously change the line, the Vilnius drama and the people in the streets, and that's where the story began. Also the handling of the Maidan was in a way the source of the next problem, because it then led to a messy conclusion, to the ousting of the president, through a process that certainly was not clean in a way, divisive internally, divisive externally. So what we see today in Ukraine is a situation that suffers from deep division in on the external side and deep divisions internally that have resulted also in the difficult situations on the ground, on the security side. The spheres of influence we see, or however we want to call them, we see now the recent signing of the agreement on the Eurasian Union, and Russia is very vocal within the OSCE in presenting the new set of tools that will enhance cooperation and improve the situation in the Eurasian area, from the CSTO to the role of the CIS and the customs union, now the economic union, etc. So there is a clear process developing in that area that seems to be coming to clash with a process that is Eurocentric, the neighborhood and the role of the European Union vis-a-vis its own neighboring countries. If you look at Ukraine, following the developments and with the disappearance of Yanukovych and with the appearance of a government that is seen as in parts of the countries as a government that is very far, and with the increasing political polarization, there is a risk of lines and dividing lines appearing right across Ukraine. So this is one of the issues we are dealing with, and this is where we feel that we need to intervene to support a political, a process of political re-engagement, a process of dialogue, a process of clarification, giving a platform for everybody to engage on and to find those key elements that would allow for a reversal of the dynamics that are now problematic. So this is how, in very few words, I would introduce from my perspective the problem. In terms of addressing it from an OSCE perspective, we felt that because of the multiplicity of issues that we have on the table, we need to really use a very large set of tools. So we have the monitors on the ground. What happened as a result of the situation is that there are very different stories, very different interpretations of what is happening on the ground. And these are being amplified. And this alone is creating deeper divisions within the society. So strong polarization within the society. So having people on the ground that report back on what they see and try to rectify perceptions that may be partisan, I think, is an important part of this. And the very presence of internationals there should act as an element of at least to a certain extent, of stabilization. Supporting political processes. The dialogue and the national dialogue mediated by two former presidents, Kuchma and Kravchuk, I think is very important, needs to be supported, needs to be continued. We are there to help and to assist the Ukrainians, but there has to be a Ukrainian ownership for this. It is important that they go ahead and they take it upon themselves to carry it forward. They shouldn't be limited in their ability to engage with all relevant sides. And the government will be one of the participants in this process. It shouldn't really drive it. It should be driven by the two institutional figures on their own merit, and we as international community should support. Elections, we have been, I think the OSCE has set up the largest monitoring observation election in the history of the organization. We brought more than 1,000 people. So it is important to continue supporting political democratic processes in Ukraine. We and others are supporting actually it's mainly the Council of Europe and the Venice Commission, the constitutional reform. That will be a very important process. At some point there should be elections, parliamentary elections. It's important also to restore the centrality of the Rada, of the parliament. It seems to me that the Rada has lost some of its connections with the constituencies, especially in the East. So there will be at some point a need to reconnect. So there is, I think there is a complicated political agenda, difficult role for the international community, but the space is there. Situation on the ground is certainly not encouraging. And that's one of the areas on which we need to work to turn the process from one where the violence is prevailing to one where we go back to a political track. It is very true that we have lots of history here in Europe. One of the things I learned when I was operating here in this region was the history of the region, but I learned parallel histories of the region. So everybody has his own interpretation of what happened in the past and uses it to justify an interpretation of what should happen in future. So that's very dangerous. Maps are very dangerous. So I would encourage everybody to keep a safe distance from that when looking at the way ahead. You mentioned Crimea. First time I went to Crimea, I was staying in a hotel that, as they explained to me, used to be a Genoan fortress. And they told me there were a number of Genoan colonies there. I saw remains of Hellenic presence. I spoke to some leaders of the Tatar community who told me stories that were very different from what the Ukrainians were telling me about Crimea. And I'm not entering into the Russian narrative of this. So this also explains that basing your calls on simply on what your interpretation is or what happened may be very misleading and may complicate your way forward. International law and the rules, and I think I would like to come back to what Professor Sachs was saying. I think that must be the way forward. We need rules. We need to stick to the rules. Also there are obviously different ways of interpreting the rules. There are political also ways through negotiation to adjust the rules, but in ways that are in a way reflecting consent of all. So this also can be done. There are possibilities for flexibility. There are also processes. There are Security Council decisions, etc. So we have a number of parameters, and I think sticking to those parameters as much as possible is also a safe way to proceed. I think the Memorandum of 94 was mentioned to me. That was an important anchor, in a way, in terms of ensuring sovereignty and territorial integrity of Ukraine. The fact that it has been violated may have consequences in the future. Once again, justifying minority rights, justifying history as a basis for changes may unravel, in a way, the map of Europe as we know it. So we need to tread very carefully on that. You mentioned Kosovo, of course, and I will come to that too. On Kosovo, we saw an alignment of legal and political attitudes. There was a negotiation. There were different interpretations on how that negotiation was concluded. There were facts on the ground, and at some point there were sort of parallel realities developing. The challenge for the international community was to try to keep those realities as much as possible in line in a context where actors, international actors that have different visions and different interpretations of the facts on the ground could find an angle that would not prejudge their position in principle vis-a-vis the condition and what was happening in the territory. It seems to me that over time, political processes such as the progress of the region in general towards a process of integration, the European integration, contributed to solving a number of practical issues that may have over time also implication on the larger political question. So it seems to me a pragmatic approach focusing on solving issues that are factual issues, but related also to interpretation of a legal situation, may over time allow to come to a solution that will bring will align the international community. It is a difficult, a complicated path, of course. It seems to me we as the international community started moving in the right direction. There's still quite a way to go. So that is perhaps my understanding, and we are part of the facilitating element in all this. But even the role of a facilitator is not an easy one, because obviously this is seen in very different ways from those who want lots of facilitation and those who don't feel a need for any facilitation. I think the solution is looking ahead, looking in the direction in which you should try to move. And also there, I think something that we are increasingly putting on the agenda, on our own political agenda, whether the OSCE has any role in this is beside the point. It seems to me that we need, and now back to the Ukraine, to the Ukraine issue, we need to create an environment where the two spaces that we see building should increasingly interact with each other, not only economically, but also politically. We need, ideally a kind of integration of the integrations. And this engagement has to be the one that produces the results. This would allow also to create a political space within which then the Ukrainians can find a solution to their own problems. I don't think anybody outside should determine where Ukraine should go and what the key strategic choices of the Ukrainian people should be. It's for them really to make that decision. Obviously, they are where they are, as it was said, and so they have to take into account the political realities. In a way, this applies also to this part of the world.